Israel Finkelstein is a leading figure in the archaeology and history of ancient Israel. Over 40 years of fieldwork and research, he has helped to change the way archaeology is conducted, the Bible is interpreted, and the history of Israel is reconstructed. I sat down with Israel over several sessions to talk about how a lifetime of work has informed the story of ancient Israel. Welcome back to the Albright.
Happy to be back.
Okay. Today we're continuing our discussion of the United Monarchy. We've covered generally the United Monarchy. We've covered Saul. We've recently covered David. And now it's time to deal with Solomon, one of the most enigmatic of these monolithic figures. Tell us a little bit about your view of Solomon.
Enigmatic is the right word to use in this context for several reasons. First of all, Solomon, unlike David, is not mentioned by any other extra-biblical text. You remember probably that David is referred to as the house of David for the kingdom in the Tel Dan inscription. There is nothing like that for Solomon. At the same time, I think that Solomon is historical because I see no logic in plucking Judah, Davidic monarchs who are not mentioned in extra-biblical texts, because Solomon is not the only one who is not mentioned in ancient Near Eastern records. So he is historical, and there is, I think, a big tension between the historical Solomon and the literary Solomon, because the historical Solomon is a very modest figure. We understand this already from our previous conversations. He rules in Jerusalem in the 10th century after David, second in line in the, among the Davidic kings. How long he rules, we do not know, because again, the Bible speaks about 40 years, which is a typological number, so we can only say for a long time. Sometimes I would say in around the middle of the 10th century BC, and he too, like David, rules over a limited territory in the southern highlands. However, the biblical description is very different. The biblical description is, and this is another thing to say about enigmatic, the biblical description is a description of an idyllic figure. This Solomon sits in Jerusalem, rules over vast territories. He is the wisest of all kings. He is the great builder. He of the temple and of towns in the countryside. He is the great trader, almost rules over the entire world in his trade. So this is not an historical description if we compare what we know from archaeology to the text.
Let's look at the character of Solomon, this enigmatic figure. Tell us about the text.
Yes, the character of Solomon. When reading the text, to me, it is very obvious that we are dealing with different figures. Well, the same figure, but described in different ways. In my opinion, there are three Solomons, so to speak, in the biblical text. There is the Solomon of the first book of Kings, chapters 1 and 2. This Solomon is somewhat passive. He is waiting in line to come to the throne. Bathsheba organizes the whole thing there. And then there is this bloodbath in Jerusalem, and he comes to the throne of David after David passes away. The second Solomon is the great Solomon, sitting on his throne with the stories in the first book of Kings between chapter 3 and chapter 10. Part of it should be taken out as a separate block because it deals with the story of the construction of the temple. But the famous scenes that all of us know about King Solomon as the builder, as the trader, as the judgment of Solomon, as the Queen of Sheba coming to visit with him in Jerusalem, all this is the second Solomon in these chapters in the first book of Kings. And then there is a third Solomon, which is very surprising because we read about this wonderful great Solomon and we turn the page from chapter 10 to chapter 11, and what do we find? All of a sudden, we find a very negative view of King Solomon. The text, the biblical text says that this King Solomon, when he became old, he married all these foreign women. And the foreign women took him away from the path of the God of Israel, and he became a sinner, he became an apostate, to the extent that the God of Israel was so furious about the way he conducts himself, King Solomon, that he decides because of that to break the great united monarchy and make Israel and Judah split to the two Hebrew kingdoms. So these are the three Solomons. And in biblical scholarship, historical scholarship, there were frantic attempts, I would say, to try to harmonize the three Solomons that I have just described. But of course, they cannot be harmonized. I mean, there's no way to harmonize the second Solomon with the apostate that we get in the chapter 11 of the first book of Kings. The meaning is that we need to try to read the three Solomons on as different texts on different backgrounds, which means that here too, we have accumulation of several layers in the description of King Solomon in the Bible, in the same way that we spoke about the layers in the story of King David.
Okay, let's take them one at a time. The first Solomon.
The first Solomon, I think, is relatively easy to decipher, because what do we have here? We have here the end of the succession history. In the conversation about King David, we refer to the theory of Leonard Rost from the 20s of the 20th century. He identified two blocks in the two books of Samuel, the rise of David to power and the succession history or the court history. And the succession history is a block which tells the story of how did it happen that Solomon, who was not the first to the throne of David, was the one who finally inherited the kingdom, inherited the throne. So Rost suggested in the 20th century, in the beginning of the 20th century, that the story is an apology. The story is meant to legitimate the fact that Solomon sits now on the throne of David, and not the ones who were the first to the throne, like Amnon, like Adonijah, Absalom, if you wish. Why Solomon? So we spoke about it in the context of King David. We need to identify the moment when this legitimacy is needed. So Rost said in the 10th century BC, when Solomon came to power, meaning is that Solomon comes to power and people around him start chatting, you know, to each other and gossiping. Well, this guy is not the first to the throne. What's going on here? So he needs legitimacy. But we know today that there is no context of composition of writing in Judah to enable composition of such an elaborate text in the 10th century BC, and for other reasons as well, there's no way to see it on the background of the 10th century, too different from the theory of Rost, which was accepted by many scholars, but, you know, a century ago, 50 years ago. So the question to ask is, what is the moment that Solomon needs legitimacy, and there is no way to eliminate the negative aspect of him not being the first to the throne? And the answer, as we said in the conversation about King David, is in the context of the migration of many Israelites into Judah after the fall of the Northern Kingdom, the takeover by Assyria in 720 BC. So this is the moment when Judah is becoming a mixed society of Judahites and Israelites, and the Israelites are coming with negative memories of the or attitude to the Davidic dynasty. So probably the Israelites who are these who are coming and chatting, you know, what are you telling us this great story about your great King Solomon? He was not even legitimate. He was not even the first to the throne. How did he come to the throne exactly? And then they tell the story of the succession, which means they legitimize Solomon. And as we said in the story, in our conversation about King David, the historical context to understand this is in the very late 8th century, when Judah was transformed into a mixed Judah-Israel kingdom, or perhaps in the very beginning of the 7th century, but a short time after this transformation of Judah. So this is relatively easy to answer.
What about the second Solomon, the builder, the wise guy?
Oh, yes, the second Solomon. So I'm going to trick you here a little bit, Matt, with your permission.
Okay.
Before speaking about the second Solomon, I wish to speak about the third Solomon.
Okay.
Because the third Solomon illuminates the second and makes it possible to maybe even suggest a date for the second Solomon. And why am I saying this? Because the third Solomon in chapter 11 in the first book of Kings, the sinner, Solomon the sinner, the apostate, with the foreign women taking him away from the path of the Lord of Israel, the God of Israel, to worshiping the deities of the neighboring nations. So the language there is typically Deuteronomistic. So we are there in a context, probably, of the late 7th century BC, which means Deuteronomistic time of King Josiah of Judah. If this is the composition of King Josiah, what does it mean? What does it mean making Solomon all of a sudden an apostate? There must be a lesson here. Why? The answer should be that this relates to the great Solomon. That this is an answer of the Deuteronomistic camp to the great Solomon, which means they are sitting there and saying, well, guys, you wanted a great king? You wanted the great Solomon? You got this great Solomon, this king of globalization, sitting there on his throne and trading with lands afar, and a foreign queen is coming to visit him from Arabia. All this, where does it lead to? All this package leads to one thing. It leads to apostasy. It leads to relations with foreign people. It leads to influence of foreign religion. It leads to the Solomon that you see now in chapter 11, in the Deuteronomistic Solomon. The meaning is that the second Solomon, the great Solomon, must be a composition, a step back from the third Solomon, which means a step back from the late 7th century BC.
So the third Solomon is Deuteronomistic. Let's get back to the second Solomon, who's the Solomon we all know and love.
Yes, this is the wonderful Solomon. So this Solomon, we need first of all to understand, he sits on a throne in Jerusalem. When I read a text like this, I say to myself, what am I seeing? I'm seeing a great Assyrian monarch. He is described as a great Assyrian king. I mean, they have in mind whom? Sennacherib, Sargon II, Ashurbanipal, one of them. He is an Assyrian king. And this is the first clue, I think, for us to look at the Assyrian century in the history of Judah in order to decipher the reality behind this Solomon. Now, there is one more thing to say about the second Solomon. We have all these traditions. I suggested already to pluck, to take out to the description of the construction of the temple. This is a separate block, put it aside. Then we assemble all the other traditions about Solomon, the great, you know, wise king, builder, trader, and so on. We described it already as such. There is good reason to believe that we see some sort of a unified text, a text. What is this text? So here we are reminded that in the First Book of Kings, chapter 11, verse 41, there is reference to the Book of the Acts of Solomon. So the question is whether what we are reading here is a composition which comes, is not perhaps the very Book of the Acts of King Solomon, but it comes from the tradition of a manuscript, a composition that was there in front of the eyes of the later Deuteronomistic author who put everything together and used this slightly earlier Book of the Acts of Solomon and his composition in the late 7th century BC.
In the next episode, we're going to talk a little bit more about the history of literacy and writing in Israel. So I know that will inform the next question a little bit, but can you give us some idea now about how you would date the Book of the Acts of Solomon?
First thing to say is that if indeed we are looking at an Assyrian monarch sitting on his throne, as the tradition, we are within the capacity or in the framework of the Assyrian century in the history of Judah, that is to say, between 730 BC and around 630 BC, when the Assyrians pulled out. So we know where we are approximately. But the memories can be broader than the Assyrian century. As far as I can judge, one needs to try to verify the reality in each and every of the stories. There are many episodes in this second Solomon, if you wish, in chapters 3 to 10 in the first book of Kings. And it is possible to throw light, to shed light on each of the episodes from the point of view of archaeology and history of the region, of the ancient Near East. When we do this, I think that we need to pinpoint on two phases, two periods. One is the period of prosperity of the Northern Kingdom in the first half of the 8th century, in the days of Jeroboam II, king of Israel. And the second one is the time of King Manasseh in Judah in the first half of the 7th century. This King Manasseh, who ruled for 55 years, and he was the one who really was fully incorporated into the Assyrian Empire, into the globalized economy of the Assyrian Empire. And this is indeed something which unites, perhaps to say, between the two traditions of Jeroboam and Manasseh, that the two of them give the impression of their period, gives the impression of great kings who rule over their kingdom in a period of trade, prosperity, globalized activity.
You see elements of Solomon's story that are reminiscent of Jeroboam II in the Northern Kingdom and also from the days of Manasseh. Let's look at each of those separately. Jeroboam II.
So we start with Jeroboam II.
Yeah.
A reminder first that in the court history, there are also memories that can be understood only on the background of the Northern Kingdom in the time of Jeroboam II. So I refer here to our conversation about the court history about King David. Mm-hmm. So this needs to be kept in the background of our talks today about Solomon. I see four episodes in the story of the great Solomon, of the my second Solomon, which probably come from the memory of the Northern Kingdom in the time of Jeroboam II. I refer to the following. First, the construction of Hazor, Megiddo, and Gezer. Second, the horses, Solomon's horses and chariots and stalls. Third, the description of Hiram, king of Tyre, and his relations with Solomon. And fourth, the Solomonic districts in the chapter number 4 in the first book of Kings. And I think that should take each and every one of them by itself.
Okay, let's start with Megiddo.
Let's start with Megiddo. We, the two of us, are close to Megiddo, so we start with something which is close to our hearts. The construction of Hazor, Megiddo, and Gezer. This is the famous verse in the chapter 9, verse 15 of the first book of Kings. Solomon is a builder. It was used, you know, in order to identify in the history of research, so to speak, buildings at Megiddo and to put them on the background of King Solomon, which was not a very successful project, if I may say so. Interesting to say that the description of Solomon as a builder, apart from Jerusalem, apart from the palace and the temple, the Bible does not speak about Solomon as a builder in Judah. The Bible speaks about three cities which are the main administrative centers of the Northern Kingdom of Israel after the split of the two kingdoms according to the biblical tradition. Hazor is in the upper Jordan Valley on the border of Damascus. Megiddo is sitting on the breadbasket of ancient Israel in the Jezreel Valley. And Gezer is in the southwestern corner of the Kingdom of Israel facing the Philistine cities. So why these three and when? Looking at the archaeology of the three places, the three sites, there are two possibilities. One, in the time of the Omrite kingdom. The Omrites were already strong enough to take over Hazor and establish it as a center in the north. Definitely construction of palaces at Megiddo and also possibly at Giza. But I think that this first half of the 8th century BC is perhaps a better time for this. Why? Because Giza is better understood on the background of the 8th century. The main construction, the main fortification at Giza should probably be dated to the 8th century BC. So I think that the 8th century is a good state setting for the mention together of Hatzor, Megiddo, and Giza. From there we go to an easier case to the cipher, and this is the story of the horses of Solomon. The first book of Kings in the chapters that describe my second Solomon refers several times to Solomon as trader of horses, as having cities of chariots and stalls and horses. The horses are very central in the story of King Solomon. When we look at the reality on the ground, we cannot ignore the situation at Megiddo in the first half of the 8th century. At that time, Megiddo is transformed into a, how to say, city of horses. They take the northern kingdom, the best real estate of the kingdom at Megiddo on the valley, and make it, you know, a city of horses and stalls. The most important buildings are the 17 altogether stables at Megiddo. Why is that? Because Jeroboam II profits from trading with horses. He profits from importing horses from Egypt, breeding them and training them at Megiddo and the Jezreel Valley, and then selling them to the armies of the neighboring kingdoms, including, of course, the Assyrian Empire. The empire needs Egyptian horses. These are the horses which are good for the chariots rather than the northern horses, which are smaller and not as good as the bigger horses from the south. So the stage setting for the story is in the beginning of the 8th century. Megiddo of the beginning of the 8th century, I suppose, when we combine it with the other tradition of Solomon active as a builder of Megiddo. The third episode to look at is the story of the relationship between Solomon and Hiram, king of Tyre. The Bible says that this Hiram, king of Tyre, on the Phoenician coast, sends trees to Solomon to build the temple in Jerusalem. Who is this Hiram, king of Tyre? Scholars describing as Hiram the First. And they take this Hiram the First from two late compositions from the second century BC, from the Hellenistic period, of Hellenistic writers who describe the history of Tyre, listing the kings of Tyre. And among the kings of Tyre, they list Hiram the First. If they list Hiram the First in the 10th century, it is easy to connect him to King Solomon in the 10th century. However, there is a very strong circular argument here. And why is that? Because in the second century BC, there was already translation of the Bible to Greek. So the Hellenistic writers could have taken Hiram from the Bible and put him in the time of King Solomon in Tyre. So this is a full circular argument. The historical Hiram, whom we know, is the Hiram mentioned in the Assyrian texts in the time of Tiglath-Pileser, king of Assyria, in the 30s of the 8th century BC, so in the second half of the 8th century BC. So here we are again in a context of the 8th century, in a context also which fits better the northern kingdom in the 8th century BC, here perhaps after the big prosperity in the time of Jeroboam II, but still in the north. The fourth text, which should be understood, in my opinion, on the background of the northern kingdom, and specifically the time of Jeroboam II, is the list of districts, administrative division of the kingdom, which appears in chapter 4 in the first book of Kings. Looking at the list, it is possible to identify the locations and, in fact, make a map with the different districts. Altogether, one can come to the conclusion that there are 12 districts. It depends how you count them together. But in any event, it is interesting to see that the background fits very well the Northern Kingdom in the time of Jeroboam II. There are two very strong clues for that, or three. One clue is that the conquests of the Omrites in the northern part of Moab are not mentioned, which means that text acknowledges already that the northern part of Moab does not belong anymore to the Kingdom of Israel. And the second clue is that the conquest of Jeroboam II in the northern part of Transjordan, including the Bashan in southwestern Syria, are acknowledged in the list of districts of King Solomon. So we are in a context of the first half of the 8th century. There is another clue, which is even more interesting maybe than the two earlier ones, and this is how to read the reference to Judah at the end of the list. As most scholars today read the reference to Judah as belonging to the list. So if Judah is a district in the Kingdom of Solomon, perhaps this is a memory of the fact that in the time of Jeroboam II, Judah was really a vassal of the Northern Kingdom under the rule of the Northern Kingdom. So the list in chapter 4 probably comes from the north, from the time of Jeroboam II.
Which Solomon stories portray realities from the days of Manasseh?
I think two of them especially, more than others. The first one is the very well-known visit of the Queen of Sheba to Jerusalem, visit with Solomon. This is a fascinating text. Some scholars tend to put it even later than the 7th century BC. I do not agree with them. I think that the stage setting, the background for the story is the participation of Judah in the Assyrian-led Arabian trade, which means under Assyrian hegemony. Judah was there located perfectly in a good place in order to help the Assyrians control the northern end of the main route that came from Arabia and went along the Edomite plateau and then through the Beersheba Valley to the Mediterranean, to Gaza, to the main highways. And Judah, as a vassal of Assyria, was there to supply services to the road in the Beersheba Valley, guards and supplies and so on. So the background must be the participation of Judah in the Assyrian-led Arabian trade. I need to admit that this starts in the very late 8th century, in the time of Tiglath-Pileser III and later, but better to put it on the background of King Manasseh, also because there are several clues that come from archaeology. There are South Arabian inscriptions that were found, a few, in the Beersheba Valley and in Jerusalem. There is reference from recent years from a monumental inscription found in South Arabia, not in context, but still probably authentic, referring, dated to around 600 BC, and referring to the towns of Judah as partners of trade with Arabia. There are the references in the Assyrian records to the phenomenon of Arabian queens in the late 8th and 7th centuries BC. So all this, I think, is better put on the background of the days of King Manasseh. Another episode is the story of Etzion Geber as the place from where Solomon sent these expeditions to land afar in the south to bring exotic commodities, exotic things. Now, the identification of Etzion Geber is a very tricky thing. It can be identified either with the, well, in any way at the head of the Gulf of Aqaba, of course, but there are two possibilities there, either under the city of Aqaba today or in Tel el-Khalefe, which is a small mound excavated by an American archaeologist, the famous Nelson Glick, in the late 30s and early 40s of the 20th century. Now, under Aqaba, there is a lot going on in recent years, excavations, and there is no clue whatsoever for a site from the Iron Age. So we are left with the Tel El Khalefe. This is a small tell on the border between Israel and Jordan today, at the head of the Gulf of Aqaba, the excavation of Nelson Glick. And the interesting feature about a piece of information about this place is that there is no evidence for activity there in the time of King Solomon. There is no 10th century at Tel El Khalefe, and there is no 10th century at all in any of the sites at the head of the Gulf of Aqaba. The earliest material culture finds at Tel El Khalefe, the earliest evidence is from the late 8th century, perhaps beginning, first half of the 8th century BC. So this also fits one way or the other, the whole story of the Arabian trade under Assyrian dominance, starting in the late 8th century, but maybe Manasseh is a better candidate because he is the main monarch of Judah during the period of Assyrian hegemony over the southern kingdom.
Speaking of Nelson Glick, who served two terms as director here at the Albright Institute, as you know, he also identified the connection between Solomon and copper trade and copper production.
Solomon and copper is really interesting in relation to Glick and also scholars today, because there is no reference whatsoever in the Bible for Solomon active in quarrying copper in the south, or Solomon involved in copper industry in the south. The only reference is for Solomon making tools for the temple, copper tools for the temple, and this refers to the Jordan Valley somewhere east of Shechem, northeast of Jerusalem, not at all in the south. But I think that Nelson Glick took the idea of Solomon one way or the other connected to copper in this story of the temple tools on one hand, and copper Solomon as trader from Etzion Geber in the south on the other hand, and combined them together, and he came with this fantasy of Solomon as the copper king, the great copper king, to the extent that we see that he spoke about this small site at the head of the Gulf of Aqaba. I would say this almost miserable site at the head of the Gulf of Aqaba, describing it as Pittsburgh of Palestine in the beginning of the 1940s. It shows you how far he was carried away with, you know, the images that come from the biblical text. And of course, the finds at Tel Khalefe do not support any activity, neither from the 10th century BC nor copper industry. So we need to brush all this aside. In recent years, several scholars revived this idea of Solomon as a copper king active on behalf of Judah in the south, in the Araba Valley, either in Wadi Fenan, south of the Dead Sea, or in Timna, near Eilat, farther to the south. I'm speaking about my friends Tom Levy and Erez Ben Yosef, a colleague of mine from Tel Aviv University. Both of them carry wonderful, amazing projects in the south, really illuminating the role of copper in the history of the entire region in the Iron Age. But I think that the revival of the memory of King Solomon with activity in the copper industry is really not supported by either archaeology or the biblical text.
Somehow your second Solomon then is telling the story of Jeroboam II and Manasseh as these very successful globalized kings.
Yes, first thing to do is to make a separation, to separate between the memories and the actual writing. The memories come from the period of Jeroboam II and Manasseh. The writing, when? So we are now speaking about writing. I think that the book of the Acts of Solomon, as we described it, with these episodes of the great Solomon, between chapter 3 and 10 in the first book of Kings, was composed in the time of Manasseh in order to legitimize the participation of Judah in the in the Assyrian globalization, in the globalized economy of Assyria, and also of Judah. And so this is one reason, and the way to do it was to take examples from the past. So Manasseh is saying, well, I am not the first to engage in globalization. Look at our king, the great King Solomon, one of the founders, the one who founded the temple, the one who founded, established the palace in Jerusalem. He was the first great king of globalization. And then he also competes with the northerners who come to him living in Jerusalem and saying, well, our king Jeroboam II was the greatest of all kings of all Hebrew kings, Israel and Judah combined. So he says to them, well, yes, indeed, he engaged too. He also engaged in globalization, and I do the same. So I am not only the new Solomon, I am also for you the new Jeroboam II. So there is this play here between Manasseh, in my opinion, and Solomon. Manasseh is Solomon, and Solomon is Manasseh. And this also explains the negative attitude to Solomon in chapter 11, which is typically deuteronomistic, because we know that in the 7th century BC, there was this clash in Jerusalem between two parties, if you wish, the parties of the God of Israel and the syncretistic parties supporting globalization, trade under Assyria, and so on. So Josiah is with the Deuteronomists, and Manasseh is the symbol of globalization, so they condemn Manasseh, and they describe Manasseh as the ultimate villain, in fact, in the Book of Kings. What do they say? They say that the God of Israel was so furious about the policies of Manasseh and the apostasy of Manasseh, parentheses, because of his relationships with the neighboring nations and so on and so forth. And so the God of Israel was so angry at Manasseh that despite of the pity of Josiah, his grandson, he decided to destroy Jerusalem and the kingdom of Judah because of the sins of Manasseh. So I think that reading the book of the Acts of Solomon and the background of Manasseh is really wrapping up the whole situation in the 7th century BC in Jerusalem. This text probably comes from the time of King Manasseh.
According to the text and the subsequent history, one of Solomon's greatest achievements was the temple in Jerusalem. How does that fit in?
Indeed, the temple. Here we also need to make us to distinguish between the reality of the temple and the composition of the text relating to Solomon. The composition of the text is, I think, late, and maybe there are even several layers there. But what is the reality? One can say that if the description of Solomon is not historical, the construction of the temple is also not historical. But I'm not saying this. The reason is that there was certainly a temple in Jerusalem, in the sense that every territorial kingdom of the Iron Age, and in fact every city-state in the Bronze Age, had palace and temple. And the temple usually was the temple of the dynasty. So palace and temple nearby, and there is no reason to argue that Jerusalem was the only exception in the Iron Age, because we know a lot about these places also from both ancient and recent texts, and in certain cases from archaeology, both for the Bronze Age and the Iron Age. So though we cannot excavate in the Temple Mount, and though we cannot visit the Temple Mount and point to a wall built by Solomon, there is good reason to argue that there was, of course, more than a good reason to argue. There was a temple on the Temple Mount next to the palace in the 10th century, in the time of the founders of the Davidic dynasty. The only question is whether the temple was first built by Solomon, or as some scholars, several German scholars suggested years ago, that there was there a temple in the Bronze Age. Logical to argue, right? It was a hub of a city-state, so there must have been a palace and a temple there as early as the Bronze Age, at least the late Bronze Age, if not earlier. So did Solomon renovate an old temple, or did Solomon construct a new temple for the new dynasty of King David? We don't know, and there is no way to know.
It sounds like we've taken so much of Solomon out of Solomon. Where does that leave us? Summarize what we said here today.
To summarize, Though Solomon is not mentioned in any extra-biblical text, he is probably an historical figure, the second in the lineage of the Davidites in Jerusalem. If so, he ruled from a modest town over a modest territory in the southern highlands, meaning that there is this tension between the historical Solomon and the biblical description, especially in chapters 3 to 10 in the first book of Kings, of this great Assyrian-like monarch sitting on his throne in Jerusalem, ruling over vast territories and trading with lands afar. Once we look into the description of the biblical Solomon, we can see that it is made of several layers, in a way similar to the description of King David, an early layer supposedly composed in the late 8th century and describing Solomon as the king, you know, who comes to the throne of David immediately after the death of the great king. Then we have the great Solomon, according to my understanding, a text that comes from the days of King Manasseh, legitimizing the participation of Judah in the global Assyrian economy, also competing with the memory of another great king among the Hebrew monarchs, Jeroboam II of the Northern Kingdom. And finally, we have the third and maybe most surprising Solomon, the one who is condemned as an apostate in chapter 11 in a typically Deuteronomistic text, which also wraps up the entire description on the background of the rivalry in Jerusalem in the 7th century BC between those who supported cooperation with Assyria and those who were more on the Deuteronomistic side.
Thank you, Israel. Next time, I'm looking forward to asking you several questions about writing and literacy in ancient Israel.
Thanks, Matt.